All right, let's go ahead and kick this thing off. So this is our last proper lecture of pathophysiology tonight. But hopefully that's a good thing for you guys. All right, there we go. Okay, so I want to try to get through this lecture, and then the rest of the time I want to spend reviewing you guys for your final. So hopefully it'll be an early night. We just have this review for the final. And then the final will be on Monday. If you could, please bring a 100-question Scantron with you on Monday. It's a little 50 front, 50 back kind of thing. That'll just help me grade them real quick. That way you guys can know your grades on Monday. And then Wednesday we'll start pharmacology. And yes, sir.
Where do you guys catch on it?
Bookstore. Yeah, you get them for about 15 cents. Okay. Yeah, or just have someone. They sell them in like little packs of six or seven as well.
Yeah.
And yeah, someone might just snag one from somebody. All right, you guys go with that? All right. You guys look tired. You guys are not looking very pleasant today at all. Hostility here. Okay. All right. So what we're going to talk about today is coagulation, right? Or hemostasis. How do we control bleeding physiologically? So the big picture. Okay. Look away from all that stuff there, and let's just go to the big picture. So the big picture is you're bleeding out, right? And platelets begin to aggregate, right? So platelets are activated. They aggregate. They clump together. And they form a rather temporary plug. And then on top of that temporary plug, ultimately what happens is a fibrin clot forms, or a fibrin mesh forms over those platelets. And then that creates a permanent plug. And then, of course, healing can occur through cell division and all that. So that's kind of the big picture. So the big picture is this fibrin here. And this fibrin is basically a molecule that's really good at hooking into itself. Right? It's really good at hooking into itself. The problem is this fibrin is circulating everywhere in your blood. It's actually what we call a clotting factor, one of the many clotting factors we'll get to a little later on tonight. So if you had a bunch of this fibrin floating around in your blood, could that be a problem? Yeah, what's the obvious problem there? Yeah, exactly. You're going to start building all of these fibrin clots everywhere. So the form that fibrin takes in your blood is an inactivated form, and that's known as fibrinogen. So fibrinogen is a fibrin that has an additional molecule attached to it, and you can see here, okay, I've drawn these additional molecules attached, and the fibrin molecules can no longer fit into each other, right? And that's actually the case with our clotting factors in general. They are initially in their inactive form. And that makes sense, right? You don't want them activated until you need them, right? So they initially exist in their inactivated form, and then they have to be activated, right? And there's a whole cascade of things that can occur, and we'll get to there. But does that make sense why the clotting factors initially are in their inactive form? Because you don't want to have clots all over the place. Now, there are diseases where your clotting factors go crazy and you start clotting uncontrollably, and we'll talk about some of those in just a little bit. Okay, you guys good with that? So that's the big picture. So the next thing that you want to be aware of is that we can actually measure how well somebody clots or coagulates, what their coagulability is. And these are some of the common labs that we use to measure someone's ability to coagulate. Okay, so we measure the PT, that's known as the prothrombin time. Okay, the PT. The APTT, or the PTT, okay, they mean the same thing, is the activated partial thromboplastin time, or some people just simplify that to the partial thromboplastin time, the PTT. Okay, So you've got the prothrombin time, the PT, the activated partial, partial thromboplastin time. And then the next one is the INR, that's the international normalized ratio. It is a ratio involving the PT and PTT, okay? Another one is called the D-dimer. And the D-dimer does not look at the same thing that the PT, the PTT, and the INR looks at. The D-dimer looks at if you are hypercoagulable and if you are trying to break clots down in your body. And so occasionally, if we are worried about someone having a blood clot somewhere, we may run a D-dimer, and that D-dimer may be elevated. And an elevated D-dimer tells us that somebody is hypercoagulable, and they may have some clots, and they may be trying to break clots down. And occasionally, this is done when we suspect somebody having a pulmonary embolism, right? If they have a big blood clot in their lung, their D-dimer will be elevated. Unfortunately, lots of things can cause your D-dimer to become elevated, so it's not highly specific or sensitive when it comes to looking at things like pulmonary emboli, but that's what it does indicate. And then there's another test known as the FSP or the FDP, and that stands for fibrin split products or fibrin degradation products, okay? And it means the same thing, and it just depends on the lab that you're working for, whatever they, whatever nomenclature they use, FSP or FDP, they mean the same thing. And this is another lab that looks at breaking down of clots. And when the FSP slash FDP is elevated, okay, that means that you are breaking down lots of clots. Lots of clots are being broken down and created and all that. And this is a hallmark finding. This is a hallmark finding for a condition, an abnormal condition of clotting known as DIC. Does anyone know what DIC stands for? It stands for disseminated intravascular coagulopathy. Oh, that's a handful, isn't it? So let's break that down. So what do you suppose? So we talked about hemostasis, right? That's clotting. Coagulation is a process of clotting. So what would a coagulopathy be? So what's coag mean? Coagulate. Coagulation is blood clotting, right? Pathy is? Is what? Is pathy the study of? Ology is a study of. No, what's pathy? Right? You guys are taking pathophysiology. You better know what pathy means. Right? Pathy is dysfunction or disease, right? So coagulopathy means a dysfunction or disease of clotting. Does that make sense? So DIC is disseminated. That means it's everywhere. Intravascular means it's occurring within your blood vessels, and coagulopathy means that it's some sort of problem with clotting. And with DIC, okay, what can happen in DIC is that you become very hypercoagulable. And what happens is you begin making lots of clots. You begin clotting spontaneously. So what happens is you develop all of these tiny little clots, and then these clots go to your brain, into your kidneys, your liver, your heart, your lungs, your gastrointestinal tract, right? They go everywhere, and eventually you clot and you clot and you clot and you clot until you run out of clotting factors, and then what happens? Maybe you die, but what happens once you run out of clotting factors? You can't clot anymore, and then you begin to bleed, and you bleed, and you bleed, and you bleed, right? So this is kind of a juxtaposition of clotting and bleeding, right? And you clot till you can't clot anymore, and then you begin to bleed. And we see these people, they will bleed out from their eyes, from their nail beds. If they have an IV in place, they'll bleed out from around the IV, out of their ears, out of their nose. They'll bleed out, if they have a urinary catheter in, they'll bleed out around that, and they just bleed out everywhere.
What makes that happen?
We'll talk about some of the things that can set you up for a PIC. But does that make sense, what's going on there? If something causes you to become hypercoagulable, bam, you start clot. You shower your body with all these little clots, and then, right, you have all these ischemic organs because there are clots in the tissue beds, and then you can't clot anymore and you begin to bleed everywhere, right? So it's just a terrible mess. And how do we treat the IC? Well, we give you clotting factors, right? Well, what happens when we give you more clotting factors? Then you start clotting again, right? So then we give you anticoagulants to prevent clotting, and then you start bleeding more, and you can see how this is just a dog chasing its tail. It's a very difficult disorder, very difficult to treat if you cannot treat the underlying problem. That's the best way to treat PIC, is can you treat the underlying problem? So what are some of the underlying problems that cause DIC or make us prone to DIC? Probably the classic example is somebody who's pregnant. Because right? What happens when you get pregnant?
Yeah, blood increases.
So your blood volume definitely increases, right? Your blood volume increases, and you make more clotting factors. Why? Why would I want to be hypercoagulable if I'm pregnant? What's the advantage of being hypercoagulable?
Because you lose blood when you get pregnant.
There you go, right? Your body, right, needs to immediately be able to clot very efficiently following delivery, right? Right, following detachment of the placenta, you need to be able to coagulate. In some people, this mechanism kind of goes awry, and they become too hypercoagulable, and they can develop DIC. So DIC is something we see in pregnant patients, particularly pregnant patients that have problems like PIH, pregnancy, induced hypertension, PUP, preeclampsia, eclampsia. We see DIC as a part of that. Other things, DIC is very common in shock, in patients that have some degree of shock, like if they go into hypovolemic shock or anaphylactic shock or maybe some distributive shock, well, like anaphylactic or septic. And this is often the end point. You guys are familiar with the term irreversible shock, right? This is often what we see in people that are experiencing irreversible shock. We see DIC, right? We see something known as multi-system organ failure or multiple organ dysfunction syndrome, where their organs start failing, right? And we see them go into DIC. I've personally seen this a few times. One of the most significant times I saw it was in a kid who got stabbed. He was a high school student. He had got stabbed in his groin, and it hit his common iliac artery. He began bleeding out. It was in a fairly small town, so they took him into the OR. And they attempted to control the bleeding. They couldn't control the bleeding, so they did something called a cross clamp. You guys ever heard of that, a cross clamp procedure? So what a cross clamp is where if you have like significant bleeding somewhere, and they're having a hard time controlling that bleeding, instead of trying to find the actual vessel, wherever it may be, they'll just open you up, go to your aorta, and follow your aorta up above the level of that injury, and they'll put clamps there, and they'll just clamp the aorta. That's called a cross clamp. Right? What's that?
To the lower part of the body?
Yeah, so basically you just shut off blood. Right? But he was in shock. He was very hypothermic. He had been given lots of fluid, lots of blood products, and he was transitioning into irreversible shock and ended up going into DIC. And we had to deal with that during the flight when we flew him. He ultimately did not survive. He died a few hours after we got him to the trauma center. So DIC is something we see in very, very sick patients that have multiple organ failure, multiple organ dysfunction. You guys okay with that? So hopefully you know what the term hypercoagulable means now, right? What's thrombocyte? What does that mean, thrombocyte?
Thrombosis is a clot.
Okay, so what's cyte mean?
Cell.
Cyte means cell, right? Hist, what does hist mean?
Does what?
Hist mean. So site means cell, but what does hist mean? This is not related to the lecture at hand, but hist, like histology, right? So cytology is the study of cells. What's hist mean?
Blood.
Not blood, that's heme. Histology. Hist is tissues, right? So histology is the study of tissues. Cytology was the study of cells. Okay. So a thrombocyte is what? Is a cell, some sort of cell that does what?
Clot.
So what's the vernacular term for a thrombocyte? The vernacular term for a thrombocyte. Say again? Huh?
Like white blood cells?
It's not a white blood cell. Definitely not a white blood cell. Yeah, what's the other, what's the vernacular term for a thrombocyte? Again, you guys need to really be familiar with the terminology.
Thrombosis.
Huh? Thrombosis is a clot, right? But what's, yeah, what's another name, right? A vernacular common term for thrombocyte. You're gonna feel really, really bad when you figure this out. Come on, Google Scholars, or Siri. Like, hey Siri, what is a thrombocyte? Platelets, right? That's another term for platelet. Platelets are thrombocytes, right? Okay. All right. The other thing I want to talk about real quick is something called hemophilia. What is hemophilia? Yeah, so it literally means a love. Philia, right, is a love of blood. That doesn't really help us understand what hemophilia is. So hemophilia is a genetic disorder, and there are several types of hemophilias. It's not just one. There are several different types of hemophilia. But it's a genetic disorder where your body does not produce, either doesn't produce at all or doesn't produce enough of specific clotting factors. So you will have very low levels, very underexpressed levels, or you don't have certain clotting factors, and it just depends on the type of disorder. A lot of the hemophilias involve factor 7 here. Okay, factor 7 is one example of certain types of hemophilia. We don't have to know the specifics for this course because you guys will have hematology when you go on to paramedic school. We'll have a whole hematology lecture. The goal for pathophysiology is just to build that foundation of understanding. Okay. You guys okay there? All right, good. All right, so now what I wanna do is I wanna talk about this monster here, all right? So what I wanna talk about is how do we get a clot? How do we get a stable fibered blood that forms, right? Causes hemostasis. Well, there are two general ways we can do it, and we call these pathways. Okay. There is something known as the intrinsic pathway and something known as the extrinsic pathway. And collectively, all of this is known as the clotting cascade. Known as the clotting cascade. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start at the intrinsic pathway, and I'm going to work my way through here. Okay. So what happens is intrinsic, I think of as inside, within. So this is a pathway that is initiated within a blood vessel, within a damaged blood vessel. So what happens is the blood vessel gets damaged, and either collagen gets exposed or platelets are activated. Okay, so platelets become activated. Okay. Okay, and they have little receptors that look like glycoprotein receptors on their surface that allow them to clump together, right? Allow them to aggregate. Okay, they become sticky, quote unquote. Alright. And what that does is that begins a cascade of events. And so you have all of these different factors within your blood. Okay? And remember, what did I say? The clotting factors, are they, their default is active or inactive?
Inactive.
Inactive. The default is inactive. So the way it works in hematology is when I say, when I'm talking about an inactive factor, I just have a number. So factor 12, for example, is inactive, right? And then when that factor becomes active, I put a little A after it.
Correct.
Right. Does that make sense? So 12A is the activated form of factor 12. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So, and these factors are enzymes. And what happens is these enzymes catalyze, okay, the formation or the transition of other factors from their inactive to their active state. Does that kind of make sense there? All right. And then also what happens is the concentration of the factors increases as I cascade down. And so this is also what's known as an amplification pathway, right? So your concentration of factor 12 is very, very tiny, but through amplification that leads to a very large concentration of fibrin to create that large stable fibrin clot. Okay, so factor 12 is converted to 12A, and then factor 12A catalyzes, these are enzymes, it catalyzes a conversion of factor 11 to 11A, and then 11A catalyzes a conversion of factor 9 to 9A, and then factor 9A catalyzes a conversion of factor 10 to 10A, okay? And then 10A catalyzes the conversion of factor 2 to 2A. Now, factor 2 has a special name, another name. And the name for factor 2 is prothrombin. Okay, prothrombin. And whenever you see the term pro in front of something, that means that it is inactive. For example, next week when we start pharmacology, there are certain drugs known as prodrugs. And a prodrug is a drug that when you take it is initially inactive until it is metabolized into its active form. And probably the most common example of a prodrug for you guys would be aspirin. Acetylsalicylic acid is a prodrug. And then you ingest the aspirin, and the aspirin is converted to salicylic acid, its active form, so we call that a prodrug. So that's why we put a pro in front of a thrombin. Does that make sense? So factor 2 is also known as prothrombin, and then the activated form of factor 2 is known as thrombin. Does that make sense? You guys okay with that there? Okay. And then thrombin catalyzes a conversion of factor 1 to 1A. And factor 1 and 1A also have special names. Boy, it's so complicated, huh? It's really, a lot of this is terminology. And so factor 1 is known as fibrinogen. Okay. And guess what? Oftentimes in biology, if you see a gen, an igen after something, that also means it's inactive. For example, there is a hormone in your stomach that helps us digest protein, and it's called pepsinogen. And then pepsinogen is converted to its active form pepsin when hydrochloric acid is released, and then that helps you digest protein. Okay, so fibrinogen is factor 1, and then activated fibrinogen is known as fibrin, which is the final factor in that fibrin plug. Holy cow, right? You guys okay with that? Okay, so this is the intrinsic pathway. Intrinsic pathway is activated by damage to blood vessels, right? So collagen, exposed collagen, and activated platelets activates this pathway. Now, there is another pathway, or another way of activating this, okay? And right here at factor 10, from factor 10 on down, this here is known as the common pathway, right? Because both intrinsic and extrinsic have this in common. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to move over to the extrinsic pathway. This is another way of activating the common pathway, okay? Which bypasses this part here. And so what happens is damaged tissues can also activate the clotting cascade. So if you have damage to your tissues, those damaged tissues will release tissue factor, okay? And another substance known as thromboplastin. And there is some argument that can be had that thromboplastin and tissue factor aren't exactly the same thing, but for all practical intents and purposes, they are the same damn thing, okay? So we're not gonna get that nuanced, so I just put thromboplastin / tissue factor. It's pretty much the same thing, okay? And we're okay to think of them as the same thing for this course, okay? So tissue factor / thromboplastin, they catalyze factor 7, okay, to its active form 7A. And then factor 7A can move on down and activate factor 10, right? So normally in the intrinsic pathway, factor 9 would activate factor 10, right? But if you don't necessarily have to have this, as long as if you have this, then it's factor 7 that activates factor 10. Does that make sense? Okay, and then the common pathway begins. All right, you guys cool with that? That sort of makes sense? Sort of? All right, you guys hanging in there okay? All right, well, let's keep moving along. So, another thing that I want to point out is that there are what we call cofactors, okay? And these cofactors help with the conversion of some of the other factors. So 8, 5, and 13 are considered cofactors. So 8 converting to 8A, 8A helps with the conversion of factor 9 to 9A. Does that make sense? It's a cofactor for this. And then 5 is a cofactor for 10 here. And 13A is a cofactor for factor 1 here. And it just so happens that we need thrombin. Thrombin helps, it catalyzes the formation of these cofactors. So that's why I drew these arrows here. Does that make sense? So thrombin helps with these three cofactors here. And then the last thing that I want to point out as far as the clotting cascade goes is, do you see these green boxes here? I've drawn green boxes around some of these factors. Wherever you see a green box, that is a step, a process that cannot occur without calcium and vitamin K. So these steps depend upon calcium and vitamin K. I've got a blood bank worker here, don't I? Somewhere, right? Yes?
Yeah.
Okay. Wow, you work for a blood bank though, right?
The plasma center.
Plasma center. So maybe not. May or may not know this, but maybe. What do we do? Is there something we do when we draw blood from somebody and we want to store it? What do we have to do to it? Huh?
Or you can keep it cool.
Got to keep it cool. Good. And what else?
Additives.
Yeah, why do we put additives into it?
To keep it, my terminology, stable, kind of.
Stable, and to keep it from what?
Clotting.
Keep it from clotting, yeah. So what we do is when we draw blood for storage, we add something called sodium citrate to it. Sodium citrate binds to calcium. And so sodium citrate binds all the calcium out of the blood, and when you do that, it prevents that blood from clotting. So when you give somebody a blood transfusion, they actually, that blood that they're getting cannot clot. Right? It is not really able to clot very easily because it is very calcium poor, among many other things. But yeah, so that's one example of how this would work. Okay, you guys good with that? Is that kind of? Okay. So the last thing that I want to do in this lecture is I want to talk about some of the pharmacological considerations of this. There are a whole lot of drugs that are out there that we use to alter the clotting cascade. And we have three general categories of these drugs. We have what are known as antiplatelets, we have what are known as anticoagulants, and we have what are known as fibrinolytics. So what I want to do is I want to start at the antiplatelets. Where do you suppose the antiplatelet drugs work? If you had to guess, what do you think they work? Where do they work? Platelets. You would be completely correct. Of course, yeah. So antiplatelet drugs work here. They prevent platelets from aggregating. They prevent platelet activation. So they prevent this from occurring. So let me ask you a question. If a plug has formed, will an antiplatelet be effective at breaking that down?
Yeah.
Breaking it down?
No.
Antiplatelet drugs will not break clots down, right? They prevent further formation. Does that make sense?
So the ones that are already there, they won't get
They're already there, yeah. You can't break those down. With antiplatelets, right? Does that kind of make sense there? Okay, so there are some examples of antiplatelet drugs that you need to be aware of. The most common is aspirin, right? Aspirin, yeah. Aspirin is an antiplatelet drug. Some other ones that you want to be aware of are your glycoprotein inhibitors. Okay, these inhibit glycoprotein receptors on the surfaces of the platelets and prevent them from coming together. The specific receptors are the 2B and the 2A. So the glycoprotein 2B and 2A inhibitors. And the two ones that you want to be just familiar with, you don't have to know the dose or any of that, just be familiar with the names, are integrolin and agrostat. Okay, these are common glycoprotein inhibitors. They are given in the hospital as an intravenous infusion. Okay, in the setting of an acute coronary syndrome, right? So someone's having like unstable angina or a non-ST elevation myocardial infarction, okay, something like that. Okay, so integrolin and agrostat, and I'll leave this up here too so you guys can, when I give you guys a break, you can come up and take pictures and write things down. Okay, you guys good with that? Okay, and then I have the generic names as well. The next drug that you want to be aware of is something called Plavix or clopidogrel. Okay, very common. Okay, it actually inhibits another type of receptor. It inhibits the P2Y12ADP receptor on the platelet. You don't really have to know what that is or exactly what it does. You just have to know, okay, it inhibits another receptor on the platelet. Okay, so all three of these prevent formation of new clots by targeting the activated platelets, by preventing platelet activation. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, let's move on down. Let's move on down to the anticoagulants. Some people, or what is the vernacular term for anticoagulants you hear people say? Kind of a common term you hear somebody, oh, I'm on quote-unquote blood thinner, right? Okay, yeah, so the vernacular term for anticoagulant is a blood thinner. They do not thin your blood out, though. That's a misnomer, right? They don't thin your blood out. What they do is they block certain clotting factors or prevent the activation of certain clotting factors. Okay, so the anticoagulants work primarily within the intrinsic and common pathway. Again, let me ask you the question. do anticoagulants, once a fibrin plug is formed, will anticoagulants dissolve the plug? No. Just like antiplatelets, they prevent the formation of new clots, but they do not break a stable plug that is already formed down. Does that make sense? Okay, cool. So let me give you some examples, some common examples of anticoagulants that we see used. Heparin is perhaps one of the most common anticoagulants. Heparin can be given in two forms. It can be given what's known as unfractionated. So heparin is kind of a large molecule. And if we give it in its full form, its unfractionated form, we call that unfractionated heparin. But there's another way of giving heparin. What we can do is we can cut it up into chunks. We can cut it up into fractions. And those chunks have a lower molecular weight than the original heparin molecule. So that is known as low molecular weight heparin. Okay? And the common form of low molecular weight heparin that we run into is something known as Lovenox or enoxaparin. Okay? Heparin, unfractionated heparin, is typically given IV. Okay? It's typically given by an IV infusion when we're treating someone with an acute coronary syndrome. Right? We'll give them a loading dose of heparin, and then we'll follow it up with a continuous drip. Occasionally, heparin is also used to inject into implanted catheters and ports to prevent them from clotting.
Okay? How often do they inject?
It depends on the device, but typically, like on a daily basis or every time that device gets accessed, you'll flush it with heparin, sometimes before or after, just depending on the type of device that's used. Okay? Now, low molecular weight heparin, or Lovenox, on the other hand, is given by a subcutaneous injection, typically in the abdomen. And this is commonly given to patients who are hospitalized. And it's given as a prophylaxis, as a preventative to prevent DVTs. What's a DVT?
Deep
vein thrombosis, right? Where do they typically develop? Yeah, your legs, right? And they typically develop in people who are not moving around a whole lot, i.e. maybe they're in the hospital and they're very sick and they're not moving around and they have stasis of blood. So their risk for developing a DVT is higher. And so we will put them on, okay, we'll put them on Lovenox prophylaxis. Generally, they'll get it either like a once a day or every 12 hours, right? Like a 1 mg/kg. Subcutaneous, something along the lines of that. It's a pretty common dose. Okay, you guys good there? Okay, now, one thing that we need to know about heparin is we can overdose on heparin, okay? And this is very common. In fact, if you go to paramedic school and you go to the cath lab, it's very common that we as in the medical community, overdose patients on heparin all the time. We give them massive doses of heparin when they're in the cath lab, having their angiogram done or having that stent placed. We'll give them massive doses of heparin to prevent clots from forming while we're trying to get that stent in. And then we have to reverse that overdose. Okay. So if you're in a situation where you are dealing with someone who's overdosed on heparin, there is an antidote to that, and that's protamine sulfate, or protamine. Protamine is the antidote for heparin. Another thing that we need to realize is anybody who is getting heparin, there's about a 10% chance, give or take, that they will develop something known as HIT. Okay, more or less a 10% chance that if you have a patient on heparin, right, you're looking through their med list or you're taking care of them in the hospital and they're getting heparin, there's about a 10% chance that they will develop a side effect of that known as HIT. HIT stands for heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. What does thrombocytopenia mean?
Decrease in
thrombocytes. Decrease in thrombocytes, right? Penia means a decrease in cells, right? Right, and ptosis, right, is an increase, right? So thrombocytopenia is a decrease, a loss of platelets, right? That is a relatively common side effect of heparin. Okay, The other thing that you guys need to know is the specific lab test that looks at heparin is the partial thromboplastin time, the PTT. Yes. The PTT tells us what that heparin therapy is doing to them, okay? And in general, if the PT or the PTT elevates, the higher they go, okay, the less capable we are at clotting, okay? I do not want you guys to remember what the normal values are for the labs because you're not going to remember them, first of all. And second of all, the normal values change from lab to lab. Every lab's a little different. So it's useless making you memorize that. Rather, you look at the lab and it'll tell you on the lab printout what the reference range is for that lab. And you go, oh, this the PT is 15 or whatever it may be, right? That's either high or low or a critical high, and it'll tell you on the lab printout. So don't memorize numbers, just know what the lab means, right? An elevated PTT, heparin will elevate that PTT. Right? That's heparin. The next one is Coumadin or warfarin. This is a very common anticoagulant. This is very common in patients who have something known as atrial fibrillation. Are you guys familiar with atrial fibrillation? What happens in atrial fibrillation? Yeah, the atria quiver, right? Yeah, they're perfect. Yeah, so blood clots can form in the atria, and then those blood clots can break off, and they can get pushed into the ventricles, and then they can get pumped out into our lungs and into our brain, right? And so we know that people with AFib are at very high risk for strokes, right? So that's a major risk factor for strokes, for embolic strokes, ischemic strokes. So we often put people who are in AFib or who are in AFib for long periods of time, we'll put them on Coumadin or warfarin. Okay. Now, Coumadin is an interesting drug in that it has multiple drug interactions. Multiple drugs interact with it. Okay, to include normal foods like grapefruit juice, ginkgo biloba, lots of common herbal supplements, drugs, lots of interactions, okay? So when you are taking care of a patient and you see that they have Coumadin on their drug list, and this is something people go home on, it's a home med, you need to be very good at getting, okay, are you taking any herbal supplements? Are you taking any vitamins, okay? Are you doing any other things that are not necessarily considered, part of your normal medicines? Because these drug interactions are so common. Coumadin, if somebody is overdosed on Coumadin, okay, there is a reversal agent. So the way that Coumadin works is Coumadin binds or blocks vitamin K. So what do you suppose we could give somebody who is overdosed on Coumadin? We can give them vitamin K, yeah. The other way we can do it, and this actually works for a lot of these anticoagulants, not only Coumadin, is we can give them a blood product known as FFP. What is FFP? We give somebody FFP. What does that mean? FFP stands for fresh frozen plasma. Okay? So what we do is when we get plasma, we separate. So the plasma is the liquid part of the blood, right? We pull the red blood cells and the white blood cells out of it, or as much as we can, and we concentrate the plasma. Well, guess what? What is in your plasma?
Protein.
Primarily proteins like albumin and what other proteins are in? Clotting factors. All your clotting factors are in plasma. So if somebody needs clotting factors, the easiest way to give them clotting factors is to give them FFP, to give them fresh frozen plasma. And literally is frozen, right? You literally concentrate it, you freeze it, and then if you need to give it, it needs to be thawed out in the lab and then administered. FFP will also reverse these overdoses. It's specifically Coumadin and heparin, right? Because FFP provides you with all of your clotting factors.
How long would you have to give it after an overdose? I mean, how long does it take them to thaw it out and get ready?
It can take a little while, 20, 30 minutes, and then you got to run, and then you got to do a Titan screen, right? Because you got to make sure you have the right blood type, and so it's not instant at all. It'll take a little while. Yeah. But it is definitely definitive, though. If somebody needs clotting factors, like they're hemophiliac and they don't have their specific clotting factor, you can give them FFP as well, and that'll give, they'll hit them with their clotting factors for sure. Now, there are some newer agents on the market, and these newer agents are being used instead of Coumadin, because the problem with Coumadin is it's really easy. It interacts with so many things, and it's really easy to become hypercoagulable on Coumadin. In fact, it's such a problem that patients regularly, several times a month, have to go to the hospital, get their blood drawn, and we call that a Coumadin clinic. And there is actually, many hospitals have a separate part of their lab just for Coumadin patients to come in and get their prothrombin time, the PT. So the PT is what we use to look at Coumadin. The PTT is what we use to look at heparin. You guys okay with that? All right. Cool. Now, these newer agents like Praxia and Xarelto, or Dabigatran, or that one for Xarelto, feel free to just come up and write it down. Okay. These are, Dabigatran is a direct thrombin inhibitor, and Xarelto is actually a factor 10 inhibitor, so it begins to inhibit here the common pathway. The cool thing about these newer agents is that they do not have the interactions and the side effects. So they are much safer to use with other drugs and other conditions, because you don't have all these cross-reactions and these interactions. The pitfall is, and you don't need to do as many blood draws and Coumadin clinics for these. The pitfall is these are so new that we don't have good reversal agents. So if you happen to overdose on one of these agents and you start bleeding out or you start bleeding into your head, guess what? Yeah, we have no way of treating it. And unfortunately, fresh frozen plasma does not seem to be effective for these newer agents. I have just learned recently that there is a brand new antidote out for dabigatran, and it's known as Paraxibine. But Xarelto, as far as I'm aware of, there is no effective reversal agent for Xarelto. So they're working on it. They probably will eventually have effective reversal agents, just not quite yet. Yeah?
One of those is actually a derivative of some of the fresh frozen plasma that's become an agent for it.
Yeah.
No, only reason I know is because the company I work for actually created the vaccination.
Okay. It's like an antibody. They make an antibody for it. And that very well may be Paraxibine. In fact, I'm almost positive that Paraxibine is an antibody.
I can't remember the name of
that binds to the medication. Yeah. I assume that with Xarelto, probably the best way is to make some sort of antibody against it. Yeah. You know, like you would an anti-venom. Yeah. Cool. You guys good with that? Okay. Finally, last, certainly not least, I want to talk about the last pharmacological consideration. And this is a category of medications known as the fibrinolytics. So what do you suppose that means? What does fibrinolytic mean?
Breaks the fibers.
Yeah, so of all of these three classes, the fibrinolytics are the only ones that can break or lyse, right? Lysis, lytic, lyse means to break the fibrin plug down. You guys okay with that? So fibrinolytics work right here. They dissolve, quote unquote. They break that fibrin plug down. You guys may have heard the term thrombolytic. Has anyone ever heard that term, thrombolytic? That term is not technically an accurate way of describing these, Because where's thrombin at? It's here, right? Yeah. But fibrinolytics work on fibrin. They break fibrin down, not thrombin. Okay, but people call them thrombolytics because thrombosis means a clot, right? But they do not, okay? You do not confuse them. If somebody says thrombolytic, okay, it is not thrombin and prothrombin that they're working on. It is the fibrin clot itself. So fibrinolytic is the best way of describing them, right? The best way of describing them, because that's what they do. Now, these drugs here originally came from bacteria. And not too long ago, within my lifetime, actually, which is, well, not that long, comparatively, no. So what we've noticed, anyone taking microbiology here?
Yes.
Yes? So did you do the CAMP test? No. And what? You had to have. Alpha and beta hemolysis? You did not do that in microbiology.
No.
Oh my goodness. Okay. So what we notice is we can take certain types of bacteria, strep, for example, streptococcus. And these bacteria can release chemicals that cause hemolysis. What is hemolysis? Heme is blood and breaking down of blood, right? Lysis, right? Hemolysis, so breaking down blood. And so what we do, or what was done, is you can take these bacteria and you can culture them on blood agar. You guys are familiar with the petri dishes, right? Mm-hmm. Well, what you can do is that solution, that nutrient solution, you can put blood in it. You mix blood in there, and then when you introduce a bacteria, as the bacteria will grow, you'll actually see that blood break down in that dish. It's called blood agar. That's known as hemolysis. And so somebody, some genius, looked at that and went, I wonder how the bacteria do that. And so they studied and they figured out, oh, these bacteria secrete enzymes that can break clots down. And so the very first fibrinolytic that came to market was streptokinase. And that's why it's called streptokinase, because it was originally derived from the streptococcal bacteria. And ACE means that it is an enzyme that catalyzes the breakdown of clots. Right. So that was the first fibrinolytic that was ever developed. And many others have followed, such as urokinase, tissue plasminogen activator, TPA, TNKase or tenecteplase, activase, renovase. These are all examples of fibrinolytics. I don't want you guys to remember the doses or any of that. Okay. Just know what they are and what they're used for. And these are primarily used for acute coronary syndromes, right? Somebody's having a heart attack, an ST segment elevation myocardial infarction, and we can't get them to the cath lab, right? There's some sort of delay, right? Or maybe we're at a small hospital that doesn't have a cath lab, and generally we say about a 90 minute. If you can get somebody to the cath lab within 90 minutes, then the primary treatment for their heart attack is the cath lab. If there's going to be a delay, then the primary treatment is a fibrinolytic. We will administer fibrinolytic to dissolve that clot. Does that kind of make sense there?
Is it for the brain?
And yeah, so that's one. So acute coronary syndrome. The other major indication is for stroke, but a very specific kind of stroke, because there are two types of strokes, right? There is hemorrhagic and ischemic. Want to give this for hemorrhagic, right? So what do we need to do if we're going to give this for stroke? They need a non-contrast CT scan. And generally speaking, it's about a 3 to 4.5 hour window that we have to give. And the specific drug that we typically give is TPA. Yeah, TPA is a specific fibrinolytic for strokes. All the rest of these are for acute coronary syndromes. And then the third major indication for these is occasionally we have to give them to dissolve blood clots in other areas, like if somebody has some sort of implanted port or device or some sort of central catheter and it gets clot, a clot develops, they may inject a small dose of this in there to dissolve the clot in that port and to reestablish its patency. So that may be another area where you see it used. Okay? You guys okay with that? Is that
kind of... What is your word after thrombolytic, under the fibrillitic?
Misnomer, yeah. So it's kind of a... Yeah.
Misnomer,
yeah. So it's... They don't work on thrombin, they work on fibrin. Cool. Are you guys okay with that? That's a whole bunch of information, huh? And a whole bunch of physiology and pathophysiology all kind of rolled up in one, but there we go. Okay, well, guess what? It's been a little over an hour. Let's get you guys out on a break. I'll see